So people say to me, you know, of all these things, you're always out there criticizing him. Can't you find something about him that you like? Is there anything about him that you can compliment or you can say something good about? And I thought long and hard about it, and I thought there's got to be something that I agree with. There's something that he's doing right. And I finally found a program that I absolutely love. Man, this is the greatest program, my favorite of all. Cash for Clunkers. Now you're a little confused right now. I'll tell you what, it's not just that, I got to say, I'm proud to say, I'm the only doctor in this country who drives a car that has officially been declared a clunker by his own cousin in chief. It's true, it's in the parking lot right now. I don't love this program because it was a great economic program. It was a miserable failure of an economic program. I love this program because it's the best education we can ever have for our kids. This is the best example. If you want your friends, if you want your kids, if you want your grandkids to understand the failure of the bailout mentality, explain to them the Cash for Clunkers program. It encapsulates everything we know about a bailout program and why they're always destined to fail. So think about this. I've challenged the economists. I said, find for me the economist who will say the right thing for a nation to do is to take its resources, its time, and its treasure and build durable goods. And while those durable goods are still valuable, use more of your time and treasure and more of your resources to destroy them. Try to explain that to my grandmother who lived through the Great Depression. The whole concept is just ridiculous. And there's not an economist who will try to make that argument. And so the program. The program was that if you would quit driving your SUV and buy one of these, you know, these little hybrids with a singer under the hood, if you drive one of those cars, then that they'd give you some money back, but they would destroy that car. And so it started out as a $1 billion program, but like all government programs, it ballooned real quickly into a $4 billion program. And they gave these rebates. It's in a very limited time, and it's only for one thing. This is why it's so measurable. Any other thing, you're going to talk about bailouts and failing, they're going to try to confuse the issue and say, well, this other factor and this happened and that happened. But you can't confuse this issue because it's so darn simple. We spent $4 billion, and for a month, we gave rebates. We gave tax money. If you'd go buy the car that, you know, because you're not smart enough to choose the right car to drive, the president's smarter than you, and he's going to choose what car you should drive. Now, I got to say, my car, I'm not a glutton for punishment. I'm not trying to be a miser. I think my car's actually a pretty good car. And one day I'd like to drive a nicer car, but I'm from the wing of the family that believes that before you spend money, you actually have it. And I'd like to get my kids through college first. So the people went in, they bought their cars, and the sales graph went up. They showed for a month the sales went up, and Barack said that this was more successful than they'd ever imagined. Now, a month later, it plummeted off. All we did, all a bailout ever does, is it borrows against future sales. But it doesn't end there. And if you've noticed, while he was bragging about this program for a while, Cash for Clunkers has not come across his teleprompters anytime lately. Because it's a miserable failure. When you look even at the month that he was claiming was better than they could have imagined, and you looked at the incremental sales, now he tried to include all the sales. Now anybody knows you can't include the sales that would have already been there, so you take off the sales that were there the month before, you look at the incremental sales, it's $24,000 per car. That's a miserable failure, but it doesn't end there. If only it was that good. The next month, the car's sales plummeted off, and when you average the 3 or 4 months in a row altogether, it's a flat line. We didn't sell a darn car under Cash for Clunkers. And we spent $4 billion, but it doesn't end there. Last month, my daughter, who is in high school, went out and we bought a car for her. It's her first car, and we wanted to find an SUV, something around the $10,000 range. You can't find them. They don't exist. They've been destroyed. We estimate in our family we had to spend an extra $3,000 to buy our daughter a car. Our family alone, $3,000 extra. And don't feel sorry for me. I'm just going to take that out of my extended family Christmas shopping budget. But think about the family that can only afford a $10,000 car. That car is the difference between them having a job and not. That's the difference between them making it to the hospital in their hour of need and not. And these cars don't exist anymore. But if only it was that good, it doesn't end there. The bill still hasn't been paid. My daughter will end up paying the bill on this longer than she'll be driving that car. And all of this said, this program was such a disaster, but in some ways, in an era when we measure things in the trillions, this $4 billion program seems kind of small. I think it's the best $4 billion we've spent. It's an educational program for our future. Explain this to your friends. Explain it to your kids. Let them understand why bailouts are, always have been, and always will be an utter failure. So we have this election coming up, and we have some important decisions to make. And let me just leave you with this. A lot of times we're being called to do things that we kind of feel uncomfortable doing. And I think back in part of my medical training, when I was in medical school, and you do a lot of things in that training that you never thought you were ready to do. They always come along sooner than you would have thought. And these experiences that you would wish on no one. And it starts becoming not just what you do, but who you are. And there was one moment in particular. It was the first baby I ever delivered. And I was called into this room for a precipitous delivery. It was an urgent delivery. And my attending physicians, the residents, the real doctors, they were out dealing with other emergencies. And I was all that she had. This nurse pulls me in the room. And my first statement was, let me go get the doctors. And she looked at me, you are the doctor. And so I'm probably nervous, and I'm standing there trying to figure out what I'm going to do. And I have my back to the patient, and I'm trying to get gowned up. The nurse is trying to help me. And I learned another lesson that day, that the only patients who ever ask you if it's the first time you've done something is on the first time you do something. So she says, I hope you've done this before. And I got my back to her, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, what do I say? I can't lie to her, but then again, I can't tell the truth. That's just going to introduce more panic into this situation. She doesn't need that. And so I tried to calm myself. I put a nice look over my face, talked in a slow, deep voice, and turned and said, don't you worry, you'll be fine. Looked back at the nurse with this look of panic, and I'll never forget what the nurse said to me. She leaned into my ear and said, don't you worry, you'll be fine too. We are in momentous times, and you're being called upon to do things that you may not feel comfortable doing. We all vote. We all pay attention. I know you wouldn't be here today if you didn't, but that's not enough. That was never enough. You're going to have to step outside of your comfort zone. You're going to have to talk to your friends. You're going to have to talk to your neighbors, your family. You're going to have to get them to the polls. You're going to have to go volunteer for campaigns. There's still time left. Donate money if you can. Max out if you can. Send a message that we mean it when we want to take back our country. You're going to have to get to work and do things that you never felt comfortable doing. And don't you worry, you'll be fine. Because I believe that each of us has a purpose. And I've come to believe that Barack Obama's purpose, his fate, his destiny, is to hold a mirror up to America and to show us an alternate future, one of his making, one of the fundamentally transformed, in his words, America. One, frankly, where the government is growing so powerful that it chooses its winners and it chooses its losers. And I think that I have a destiny. I think I have a purpose, no matter how great or how small. And it's to refan those flames of liberty. And they may flicker tenuously now like they did some 230 years ago in the cradle of democracy, but they're beginning to burn brighter. And in our hearts, they are roaring because we know that this is our moment. We know that we are fighting for freedom. And America is worth it. America really is the best last hope. And if we won't fight for her, who will? Because we are the proud heirs of the patriots who have come before us, and we must be as worthy in our hour as they were in theirs, because today we have our own rendezvous with destiny. And I realize that every Goliath story seeks its David, but this is something so much more. This is an army of Davids. You are the army of Davids, and we will not go silently in the night. We will not back down. We will change this Congress. We will change this country. And with the righteous winds of liberty at our backs, we will change the world. Thank you. God bless you all. What if I lead the way? What if I make mistakes? Will you? What if I change the world? Thank you. Now is our time to fight. Now is our time to rise up. Our founders face their challenges head on, and we will do the same because we have our own fight for liberty. There is a collision between two worldviews, and only one of them can ultimately prevail. You must choose. You'll either stand with the power of a growing government, or you will stand to choose with the American people. And as for me, until my last breath, I will fight for our liberty. I will fight for America. And I hope one day they can simply say of me, I hope they will say of me that I too was worthy to be called an American. Thank you. God bless you all.